Hi, very good evening. So today, this live session, we shall focus on some image-based discussion, right, pertaining to oral radiology, as we have made a schedule prior, right? So hope you're all doing fine. So once again, a very good evening. And I really hope you'll not have any network issues today. Just give me 1 second, okay? My mom is wondering how this live session is going on, and she is just coming and observing everything. Yeah. So before we start with the first one, just give me 2 minutes, right? Just focus these things and then we'll proceed. I think, and also I think I should speak out loud, right? So this is a huge room. So just let me know if I'm not audible, right? So once again, a very good evening. Hi Bernice, hi Gauro, hi Neetu, Megha, Regina, Rohit, hi Sahithi, hello Prithvi, Ramesh, Preeti, hi Preetika, Navjot, hi Navjot. Yeah, because we got the issue sorted out today. So we fought with our service provider and thankfully helped us a lot. Ambrish, hi, very good evening. Hi Kumari, hi Ashina, hello Aishwarya and Shruti, hi, very good evening. Right, so we'll just proceed with today's discussion, right, as soon as possible. We have around 8 to 10 image-based discussion, and I think it's going to take much time because it's like today we'll be discussing normal anatomic landmarks mostly, right? So I'll be projecting you some images, as you can see. So you need to identify them, right? So I have numbered them. We have numbering along the images. So you need to number them accordingly. And if necessary, I'll try to zoom out or zoom in the image, right? So we'll go with the first one. So identify the label structure here. I think it's not clear. Let me just zoom in. So this is an intraoral periapical radiograph of a maxillary posterior region. So first quadrant. So identify this structure. So I've zoomed into the max. So this is your mandibular maxillary third molar. And here you have a linear radiopaque structure. And as far as I remember, we have already discussed this particular image in one of the previous live sessions while discussing oral radiology image-based questions. Hi Elvin, hi Sadhana, hi Nisha, hi Amna, a very good evening. So the given structure here is nothing but, it's a hamillar process. So it's an extension of medial pterygoid plate, right? So I'll just give you brief information pertaining to this hamillar process. So it's also called as hamillus or hamillar process, which is a small hook-like projection of bone extending from the medial pterygoid plate of sphenoid bone. It's located usually posterior to the maxillary tuberosity region. And on the radiograph, it appears like it has varying length, width, etc. It can appear as a bulbous point, or it can appear as a tapered point, as it is evident here, right? So it appears to be tapered in this particular image. So this is hamillus or hamillar process, and it's a normal anatomic finding, right? So we'll just move on to the next one. So identify the following structures and name them according to the numbering system given here. So this is an intraoral periapical radiograph of first quadrant, maxillary central, second quadrant, maxillary, that is 2-1, 2-2 and 2-3, as you can see here, maxillary centrals as well as canine. So identify these anatomic landmarks, which are numbered as 1. Starting from 1, we have numbering till 8. So let me just zoom in. Right. Yeah, I hope it's clear. Right, okay. At least one is clear, right? So this is one. So you have a radio opaque line. You have an opaque process or extension here, that is one. And you have three here. So three, you have a kind of radiolucency, circular radiolucency. Two is not visible here clearly, right? I can understand. So two, I'll be giving you the answer directly. You wrote the two. And what about four? You have a radiopaque line. You have some kind of radiolucency in this area. And then you have a radiopaque line. And five is nothing but again, you have a slight radiopaque line. Radiopaque line, which is relatively radiolucent compared to the other radiopaque lines. You can see a line here. And you have six, which is extending along the periapical area. And seven, which is along, which is again a radiopaque border. And then you have eight, which is surrounding the root of central incisor. I think it's lateral incisor. So identify and try naming them based on the number. So two is not clear, so try naming from one to eight, excluding two. If you want, I can just zoom out. Is it fine, or do you want me to zoom out? Okay. Hi, Avneet. Oh, one, you think it's annular process? Okay. I'll just zoom out. Try to make it up. See, one appears to be a radiopaque line. As I said, one appears to be a radiopaque line. So, six, lamina dura. Okay. Six is lamina dura. Agree. 8 is actually pointed towards the PDL space. Okay, I can understand it will not be so clear for you, but 8 is pointed towards the PDL space, periodontal ligament space. Okay, Preeti, you say 1 nasal septum and 4 maxillary sinus. Okay. 3 incisive foramen. Incisive foramen? Okay. 7 maxillary sinus lining. Agreed? Yeah. So 7, it's clearly visible here, right? So we have this sinus radiolucent space. So this will be the anterior border or anterior lining of maxillary sinus. Good? Yes, Ajaj. The 5 annular bone. Okay, I can understand, but see, you have this fine radiopaque line. You can just make out in the, see, you can make out in the screen, right? So you have this fine radiopaque line. So 8 is a periodontal ligament space, as it is clear. 6 is, as you said, it is lamina dura. Okay, excellent. Yes, Bernice. So floor is nothing but the floor of nasal fossa, nasal cavity. Perfect. Yeah. So this is how we're going to have a discussion today, right? We have many similar radiographs. So I'll just explain you this, and from the next one, you try to give the answers for yourself, right? Anyways, you've done well. You have answered more than 50% of the landmarks here. And also, I can understand that it's really challenging to look into, because here it's very clear for me comparatively, but I don't know how much clarity you're having, because you try watching the video in HD quality, and I'm sure you can have a high definition image and you can answer more appropriately, right? 5, you say part of Y formation. Exactly, yes. Yes, Alvin. Yes, Sayeri. Okay, I'll give you the right answer now, okay? As you can see, just go above. So let me just zoom in to the maximum extent possible. I hope I'm audible, right? Yeah, the first one is nothing but nasopalatine duct. So it's a ductal lining. So it's given as nasopalatine canal lining. So it's a lateral wall of nasopalatine canal. So we have this radiopaque line. You can just make out in the screen. So this is the lining of nasopalatine canal, and this two, we have something called as 2 here. So it appears to be more radio-opaque. So 2 is nothing but, this entire part is maxillary sinus. So this is the anterior wall of maxillary sinus. I know it's not so clear in the image, right? And 3. So this 3 is nothing but a radiolucent area, which is nothing but nasopalatine fossa. So 3 represents nasopalatine fossa. And 4, as Bernice rightly said, it's the floor of nasal cavity. And 5, it's a reflection of a soft tissue. Can you just name it? As I said, it's a reflection of soft tissue. 5. Hi Lakshmana, very good evening. So this 5 represents the reflection of soft tissue, that is the tip of the nose, right? Nose, alar process, the soft tissue. So that's why we have this fine radio-opaque line, okay? And then 7, it's nothing but the anterior border, it's again the border of maxillary sinus. And 8, as you can see, this is the periodontal ligament space. So periodontal ligament space, and 6 is nothing but lamina dura, right? So I hope it's clear. Let me just zoom out once again and answer once and for all. So as you can see here, 1 represents the wall of nasopalatine duct, and 2 represents the anterior border of maxillary sinus, 3 is nasopalatine fossa, 4 is the floor of nasal fossa, 5 is the soft tissue reflection of the nose, 6 represents lamina dura, 7 represents border of maxillary sinus, and 8 represents periodontal ligament space or perial space, right? I hope it's clear. Yeah, sure. I'll definitely share these images in our WhatsApp update group. Okay. Nasopalatine ductal wall, the wall lining. So you have this canal, nasopalatine duct. So along this duct, you have these walls made up of bone. So that's the reflection of the lateral wall of nasopalatine duct. So as such, canal appears to be radiolucent, right? Next. The third image for today. So let me just zoom in before we go into the discussion. I think if we can wait for a few seconds, this will be lost, right? So in the meantime, we can discuss, so what is 1? So what does 1 represent? So this is an IOP of third quadrant, right? I mean, the posterior quadrant. As you can see, we have molars which are restored, and then we have an impacted molar, third molar. So this is an intraoral periapical image, a radiograph of a posterior aspect, that is third quadrant. So identify the following structures. 1, 2, 3, and you have 4 and a 5, right? Hi Sairaj, this is Avneet. I think again this small box has problems. Yeah. Okay, nutrient canals, nerve and blood vessels to pulp. I'm quite sure that nerve and blood vessels cannot be seen on a radiograph, isn't it? So the passages for nerve and blood vessels, so we can have nutrient canals, as you said, trabecular pattern of radicular bone, inferior alveolar canal, inferior alveolar nerve. So is it nerve or is it canal? Or is it the border of canal? So So Amnit, you say cancerous bone, right? So Bernice, you said 5 is inferior border of mandible. Okay, Alvin, Rohit, Fifi, right? Apical foramen 1. Okay. Oblique ridge. Where did this oblique ridge come from, Sayari? You mean say 3? Okay. Right. So let me just give you the answer. 5 might be an artifact. Yes, it can be an artifact, but it's not. Okay? As given in the literature, it's not. Anyways, we'll just discuss, right? So the first one, just give me a second, right? So 1 represents nutrient canals, right? As most of you rightly pointed out, 1 represents nutrient canals. 2 represents the trabecular pattern of the cancellous bone, right? We have a cancellous bone there, trabecular pattern. And 3 represents the border of inferior, we have this mandibular canal border, right? So the border appears to be radiopaque, isn't it? So 3 represents inferior border of mandibular canal. And 4 is nothing but, so what did you answer for 4? See, if you observe 4, you have some kind of radiolucency here or fossa type. It's not so prominent, I can understand. 4 represents submandibular gland fossa. Whereas 5 represents, it can be an artifact or it can be even an inferior border of mandible, right? Yeah. So 1, nutrient canals. 2, trabecular pattern of cancellous bone. 3 represents the inferior border of mandibular canal or the lining of mandibular canal. 4 represents submandibular gland fossa. 5 represents inferior border of mandible, right? Yes. Yes, Amna. Mylohyoid line, okay. See, mylohyoid line is something which is an anatomic landmark, right? So when you observe the medial aspect of the mandible, you find these structures, right? They are anatomic landmarks, isn't it? Yeah. Shall we move on to the next one then? So this is an intraoral periapical image, IOPA, of second quadrant, okay, maxillary posterior region. As you can see, we have sinus lining, posterior premolars as well as molars. Third molar seems to be missing here. So we have a combination of radiolucent and radiopaque structures, and we have numbering from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, right? So let me just give you a brief description of these numbering systems and then you answer it accordingly, right? I hope it's clear for you. Yeah. So 1, you can see a radiopaque border. 2, again you have a diffuse radiopaque border on the superior aspect. 3, you have this radiopaque line. 4, again you have a radiopaque border. 5 is also a radiopaque border. 6, it appears to be a bulbous kind of radiopacity. 7 also the same, a bulbous kind of radiopacity, a diffuse radiopacity, whereas 8, it appears to be a radiolucent, right? So try answering them, I'll give you the right key as soon as possible. It's practically impossible to give all the right answers, right? So try your level best and try answering as many as possible, right? So because we are only familiar with the tooth structures, the periapical areas or the linings of tooth, or if extensive, we'll just know about sinus, right? So we have a lot many structures, so nothing to worry. Even if you can't answer, just try giving an answer. At the end of the session, we'll make sure that we master all the landmarks pertaining to normal IOPs, right? So we have these various anatomic landmarks. We'll try to master all of them at the end of the session. And also before concluding the session, I'll briefly summarize all that we have discussed so far. We'll just project all the images at once and then we'll briefly name them accordingly, right? We'll try to simplify it as much as possible. Five, Sairaj, you say hiatus semilunaris. Hiatus semilunaris is nothing but a kind of opening, isn't it? It's found in lateral wall of nose. It's not as such a radiographic structure. Anyways, well tried. Weirdness? Okay, quite weak in radiology. But today is better. Okay. Alvin, four, wall of maxillary sinus. Okay. Lavanya, Rohit, Burness. Okay, Ajaj, first anterior border of maxillary sinus. Great, great, Ajaj. Okay, seven, hamular process according to Preeti. Okay. As I said, hamular process will be like, it can be a bulbous point or it can be a tapered structure, right? Aishwarya, you say five, zygoma. Mm-hmm. Three, floor of maxillary sinus. If this is maxillary sinus, this becomes the roof and this forms the floor, isn't it? Avneet, you say one is lateral wall of nose. Lateral wall of nose is something which is seen in sagittal section. But as such, we don't have a kind of that kind of radiographic landmark, isn't it? So, which component is it in radiograph in lateral wall of nose? Six, tuberosity, you say? Okay, seven, hamular process. Okay, fine. So let me just give you the answer, okay? Two palate. Okay, right. So as you can see, one here, so we have this radiopaque border, right? So one represents, so as you can see, one represents the anterior border of maxillary sinus. This entire part is maxillary sinus, isn't it? So this is anterior border of maxillary sinus, isn't it? So this forms the floor of maxillary sinus. And two represents inferior nasal concha. Concha, we have this nasal concha, right? So two represents inferior nasal concha. Three represents the floor of nasal cavity. Three represents the floor of nasal cavity or nasal fossa. And four represents the border of zygomatic process of maxilla. So you have the zygomatic process of maxilla. So this forms the inferior border and this forms the posterior border, right? So this is zygomatic process of maxilla. This is the inferior border and this is the posterior wall of zygomatic process. Whereas six is nothing but the inferior border of zygomatic arch. So we have the zygomatic arch. So this forms the inferior border of zygomatic arch. And seven represents maxillary tuberosity. So we have this diffuse bulbous radiopaque structure posterior to the molar. So this is maxillary tuberosity. And eight represents the mucosa over maxillary alveolar ridge. Hence it is comparatively radiolucent, right? It's not completely radiolucent like A, or it is not completely radiopaque like bone. So it is a mucosa over the residual alveolar ridge, right? So one, anterior border of maxillary sinus. Two, inferior nasal concha. Three, floor of nasal cavity. So this is a nasal cavity, right? Nasal concha, nasal cavities and all floor. Four represents the inferior border of zygomatic process of maxilla. As such, this entire thing is zygomatic process of maxilla, whereas this is zygomatic arch, right? So can you visualize? So this is zygomatic process of maxilla and we have a zygomatic arch here, right? So this is inferior border of zygomatic process of maxilla. And this forms the posterior wall of zygomatic process of maxilla. Whereas we have the six, which represents the inferior border of zygomatic arch. and then 7 maxillary tuberosity, 8 represents the mucosa over the residual alveolar ridge present in this area, mucosa over the ridge. Right, I hope it's clear. Hi Priya. Okay, you say you can implement them. We have tips to learn radiology. Sure, Priya, definitely. Do share those tips with us. They'll be of enormous help. Yeah, right? So I hope it's clear. Shall we proceed to the next image then, right? Or do you want me to stop here for some time? Okay, sure Priya. Now we have been doing that, definitely. 5 represents the posterior wall, of zygomatic process of maxilla. As such, this entire thing is zygomatic process of maxilla. This is the inferior border and this is the posterior wall. Sure, we'll do that. Okay, right. So we'll proceed on with the next one. So this is comparatively simple. Let's see how many of you can answer. So we have only 3 landmarks to identify in this image. So one represents a radiopaque border between the crown and the root. So 2 represents a radiolucent area which is present in a periapical relation, which is periapical in relation to the second premolar, mandibular second premolar. So this is an intraoral periapical radiograph of the posterior aspect, right? So third quadrant, so you can see premolar side. So second is a periapical, as you can see, we have this radiolucency. And then 3, we have a diffuse kind of radiolucency, right? So name these anatomic landmarks. So as I said, we have been discussing only the normal anatomic landmarks and not the pathology. So that itself should give you the answer what 2 is all about. Yes, Priya, definitely I'll consider your suggestion. We'll try implementing that for next time. Yeah, we'll try to compare these with the clinical pictures, anatomic pictures. That would be even more superior and helps in learning, right? Thank you so much for your advice. Yes, we have answers from, yes, Bernice. Okay, Preeti. Good. Yes, Ajaj. Yes, me too. Alvin. Okay. Rohit, Taishwarya, Sairaj, Mrs. Ej. Mega Alvin. Okay. Anitu, you say apical foramen? Again, you say mental foramen. Right, fine. Yes, Gaurav. Apical foramen is not so huge. It's basically like we can visualize it properly in case of histologic section. Radiographically, it's not so prominent. But we can definitely make out. Alvin, you said 2 is periapical granuloma. As I said, we have been discussing normal anatomic landmarks that actually should give you the answer. So it's not a pathology. Yes, exactly. So it's very simple to remember. So first it represents a transition in radiopacity, isn't it? So we have this cemento enamel junction here, CEJ, junction between the crown and the root, right? And 2 represents mental foramen. So we often get confused with whether it's a pathology or a normal anatomic structure. So the clinical signs and symptoms, vitality tests and all those things definitely help us in giving the right diagnosis, and moreover we should always keep in mind the fact that we have a normal anatomic structure, mental foramen, which usually coincides with the second premolar, peripheral area of second premolar, and the best way to rule out whether it's a pathology or not through radiography technique is by implementing slot rule or Clark's rule or buccal object rule, right? So by having this shift technique, we can identify whether it's like how it is present and in what orientation is it present with respect to the root, right? So two represents metal foramen and three represents submandibular gland fossa, as we have discussed in one of the previous radiographs. So usually the shift technique or buccal object rule is used for locating any landmark or any structure and to know whether it is oriented buccally or lingually, right? So same side shift, it's same side lingual, opposite side buccal. We have this short form slob, isn't it? Same side lingual and opposite side buccal. Right? So we'll just move on to the next one. Yes, metal foramen usually seen in proximity with the peripheral area of second premolar. Right, so we have another internal peripheral image of lower anterior teeth, right? So let me just zoom in. So try numbering them. We have three numbers here, 1, 2, and 3. So as you can see, these are mandibular central incisors and laterals. So identify these structures. So one, we have these diffuse radiopacities. Two, it seems to be like a pinpoint radiolucency in between a radiopaque structure, and three represents a complete radiopaque structure, right? So what does 1, 2, and 3 represent? Genial tubercles, Lakshman, you said 2 is metal foramen. Metal foramen is something which is seen in relation to the premolars, right? So mandibular canal 3. Aishwarya, you said 2 is lingual foramen. Okay, where is 3? Okay, can't make out 3. Okay, I'm sorry. Yes. Let me just zoom out. Yeah, it's not so clear, I can understand. Yeah, so I think I can alter the contrast maybe. I'll just try altering the contrast, just let me know if it is clear or not. Can you make out now? I'm just removing that. Yeah, I think you can make that out now, right? So let me know if it is not still clear. I'll just zoom in. Yeah. Just hold on for 1 second. I think you should be able to make out now. No, one is not genial tubercle. Yeah, I think you can make out now. So we have a radiolucent structure, pinpoint radiolucent structure. as one of you rightly pointed out, lingual foramen. And we have this radiopaque structure 3. Yeah, usually they say genitubercles are 4 in number. Superior you have 2 and then below them you have 2, right? Genitubercles. Right, so let me just answer. Symphysis is something which is present. It's an anatomic landmark, right? Symphysis. So one represents torii. So one represents mandibular torii. These are radiopaque mass. In fact, initially when I saw, the moment I saw this radiograph, I assumed them to be impacted canines. But you still have canines here. So one represents torii, mandibular torii, which are commonly seen on the lingual aspects in relation to the canine, isn't it? So we have one, that is mandibular torii, and two is lingual foramen, and three genial tubercles. So three is genial tubercles, but not one. So we have genial tubercles here, right? Which is pathology? No, genial tubercles. See, torii are also not pathology. In fact, you have mandibular torii commonly found. You just refer Schaeffer's, you'll have the information given that majority of population also contains torii on the lingual aspect of the mandible, especially in the canine region. So they are normal findings. Mandibular torii are normal findings. Isn't it? Yeah. Two is lingual foramen, as Aishwarya rightly pointed out previously. Two is lingual foramen and three is genial tubercles, right? So let me just increase the contrast before going to the next image. Got used to using mobile, smartphone, touch screen, and it's really a huge challenge to operate with buttons now. Right, so we'll move on to the next one. So we have a lot many structures here. Let's see how many of you can answer them. As many, try answering them as many as possible, okay? So this is actually a section of OPG, the left part of OPG, which has been cut, and you have a lot many numbers here. So I'll zoom in as much as possible. So we'll leave out the bottom ones first. We'll try to focus on the top ones where we have a lot of clustered numbers arranged. So we'll try to focus on the top area first. Right. So I hope it's clear, or do you want me to alter the contrast? Okay, Lakshman, fine. Yeah, actually we have this lingular mandibular canal, mandibular foramen. Yes, lingual foramen. The radiolucent circle is lingual foramen. Yeah, in the anterior region. Right. So we have around 15 numbers here, right? So you can make out, so I'll just give you a brief description pertaining to each one. Let's see how many you can answer. So first let me know, is it fine for you, or do you want me to alter the contrast? I think it's fine, right? Okay. So the first one is the radiolucent structure, the radiolucent area. Second one represents a mass of radiopacity. Third one is also a radiopaque structure. Thirteenth one is also a radiopaque structure. Third one, again, you have this radiopaque lining. Fourth, again, a radiopaque lining. Fifth, you have this cluster or mass of radiopaque structure. Sixth, you have this triangular kind of radiolucency. If you can make out, it's clear here. You have this triangular form of radiolucency, and 7 is the radiopaque structure bordering that radiolucent area, and 8 is nothing but a diffuse radiopaque border. 9 again a border, a radiopaque border. 10 also represents a radiopaque border. So we have 11, which appears to be slightly radiopaque, and then we have 12, radiopaque border. The rest of the structures we will go through once we try completing them. So try answering as many as possible, okay? Okay, 11, ear lobe, okay, good. So 9, palate. So palate is present somewhere here, right? 9 is somewhere here. Okay, Sairaj, Avneet, Aishwarya, 4 maxillary sinus. So this is your sinus, right? This area, somewhere here we have sinus. 4 is almost in the orbit region, the 4 and all. Farhi, you said 3 sinus. Mm-hmm. By the way, 3 is a radiopaque structure. Inferior ulnar canal, okay, SIRE. 12 border of fibrosis, 9 coronoid process. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like both are overlapping here. We have condylar process, we have a coronoid process also, okay. 11 cervical vertebrae shadow. Cervical vertebrae almost here in this area. 1 inferior concha, okay. 10 hamulus. Judge 3 nasal septum. I'm sorry, just zooming in again. Well, it's not a pathology. As I said, these are all normal anatomic landmarks, radiographic landmarks. 13 anterior nasal spine, okay. 12 inferior nerve canal, okay, right. So we'll try answering this first and then we'll go to the posterior area, okay? So the one represents the nasal cavity, the air-filled space, right? 2 represents a nasal septum, 2. 3 represents anterior, 13 represents anterior nasal spine. 3 represents the lateral wall of the nasal fossa, because this is nasal fossa, this is the lateral wall of the fossa. 4 represents not the sinus, but it forms the floor of the inferior orbit. We have this orbit, inferior orbital ring. So 4 is inferior orbital ring. It represents inferior orbital rim or infraorbital rim. Whereas 5 is the border or lining of inferior orbital canal, right? So 5 represents the border of infraorbital canal. 6, as you can see, a radiolucent structure, that is pterygomaxillary fissure. Whereas 7 represents the posterior spine, it represents the spine of sphenoid. It's again a radiopaque structure, right? So as you can see, 7 represents a pterygoid spine of sphenoid bone. 8 you can just make out very clearly, right? You have this radiopaque mass, it represents zygomatic arch. 8 represents a zygomatic arch, whereas 9 represents the border of maxillary sinus. You have this, the border of maxillary sinus 9, and 10 represents the border of, as I said previously, zygomatic process of maxilla, right? And then 11, as one of you rightly pointed out, this represents the earlobe. It's a reflection of an earlobe. So 11 represents earlobe. And 12, as most of you rightly pointed out, it's an inferior allular canal. 14. So we have this 14 here, that is inferior border of Meynell, which is quite evident. And we have 15, which is not so clear here. So it's hyoid bone, right? Just leave out the 15th one. So these are the areas which we are most commonly confused with, right? So let me just go through all the structures once again. Yeah. 6 coincides with PTM. 1 represents the air in nasal fossa, 2 represents nasal septum, 13 represents anterior nasal spine, and 3 represents the lateral wall of nasal cavity, the lateral wall. So this is nasal cavity, this is the lateral wall. And 4 represents the infraorbital rim, 5 represents the border of infraorbital canal, 6 represents pterygomaxillary fissure, 7 represents the pterygoid plate of spinoid, pterygoid process of spinoid bone, and 8 represents the zygomatic arch, 9 represents the posterior wall of maxillary sinus, 10 represents the posterior border of zygomatic process of maxilla. So this is the zygomatic process of maxilla, so this is the posterior border, and 11 represents the earlobe, it's a soft tissue earlobe, right? And 12 represents inferior allular canal, the border of inferior allular canal, and you have 13, that is anterior nasal spine, and 14 you have inferior border of mandible, right? So you can just observe them, observe this landmark, and if you have any question you can drop them here. Radiolucent areas between high cavia, radiolucent areas between tooth, you mean you're talking about these areas? I mean, that's normal, right? You have at least 3 to 4 mm space between your CEJ and the crest of allular bone. So ideally it has to be 1 mm as far as I remember. So these are normal spaces. Because of periodontitis, because of horizontal bone loss, you have these structures here, radiolucent spaces, if you're talking about these spaces. I should have done this initially itself, so that you can have observed them even much better. Okay, right. And this is my bike. Light, awesome. Light is my reflection also. Maxillary tooth spaces. These are all normal spaces, right? Because of bone loss, it can be horizontal. You're talking about cervical burnout. Cervical burnouts will not be so prominent here. I think they'll be more prominent in case of an IOPA. All the spaces which you see here, they're nothing but horizontal bone loss, if you're talking about these spaces, right? Also, we have cervical burnout to some extent. Yeah, it will be more prominent in case of your IOPA, right? Radiolucency 1-2, yeah. So 1-1 also there is some radiolucency. Yeah, that can be fracture or that can be carious lesion. Okay. Hi, Dinchak Puja fan. Yes. So there is a reason. from the angle to symphysis. You're talking about this area. This is nothing but your inferior alveolar canal. As you said, 1, 2, I was thinking of, I was just looking at the teeth. So you're talking about the 12 number. So this is the lower border of your inferior alveolar canal, IAMB canal. Right? So shall we proceed with the next one? So I think we have already completed all of the images. We have one final image pertaining to X-ray tube, right? We'll just go through that, and again we'll try to summarize all that we have discussed so far. Right, so identify these structures based on their clock position, like 12 o'clock position, 1 o'clock position, 3 o'clock position. So identify them based on the clock position. And then finally, you can identify this one at the last, right? So you'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Right? So 10 plus 1, 11. So you need to identify total 11 structures, right? So this is a schematic representation of an X-ray tube. We have discussed in detail the X-ray tube. You can refer our e-classes and also the YouTube video for more information. So you can start from 12 o'clock or just identify the clock position and then name them accordingly. So 10 o'clock, you're talking about the filament. Okay, which filament is it? So I should use 10 o'clock is filament, albumin, cathode, anode. Okay, when is 10 filament, 11 cathode. 12 insulating glass tube. Beryllium window 6. Okay. Prithvi, you said tungsten filament. Okay, yes, it's the filament made of tungsten, isn't it? Cyrus, you said cathode. 1 vacuum, 1 o'clock. Yeah, 1 o'clock, you mean to say this area, right? So 1 o'clock vacuum. 11 o'clock, so you have focusing cup. You're talking about this? Okay, for him, you're right. So mega chain, 7 X-rays. Okay. Now what about this? So Alvin, you said filter, okay. 6 is collimator. Right. 7 o'clock aluminium. Aluminium filter, okay. Six collimator. With you say 1 focusing cup, glass tube, vacuum, copper tube, X-rays, filters, electrons, cathode, filament. Seven electrons. You mean to say electrons or X-rays? We have difference, right? Ultimately, we're trying to produce X-rays here, right? So we're using these high-speed electrons to produce X-rays. So are they electrons or X-rays? Okay, right. Exactly. So 8 o'clock you have, I mean, around this, right? Electrons, right? So I'll just give up the answer, right? So 12 o'clock question, right? So this structure represents leaded glass tube, right? So it is leaded. So it's glass encasing, isn't it? So 1 o'clock represents a vacuum which is inside, right? To prevent the burnout of the filament. And you have this, I'm sorry. Yeah, just give me 1 second. Yeah, we'll go to these structures in the meantime. So this coil is nothing but, as you said, tungsten filament. And this casing, this is molybdenum focusing cup, right? And then you have copper stem inside. So this is nothing but tungsten anode, right? Tungsten target. So this is tungsten's target, and this entire structure is copper stem. So this is anode. This forms the cathode. These are your high-speed electrons, and these are your X-rays. And this is unleaded glass casing where you can have an aluminum filter, right? And you have these X-rays here, and this represents copper stem, right? So we have cathode minus sign, anode plus sign. So cathode, there is reduction, anode, there is oxidation, right? Red cat, anox, mnemonic. And then you have this tungsten filament, tungsten target. And then you have this molybdenum focusing cup, glass encasing, vacuum, and as I said, tungsten target. And we have this copper stem, we have these X-rays, and we have these high-speed electrons going on here, right? And this is your unleaded glass encasing to allow the X-rays to pass through, where you can have an aluminum filter, right? So these are some of the structures pertaining to the X-ray tube, right? We have already discussed that in detail in one of the videos, right? You can go through that for more information, right? So before concluding, I'd like to summarize all that we have discussed so far, right? So we'll move on to the first one initially. So this is an IOP. The first one, the IOP of the maxillary posterior region, right? The first quadrant where you can see a Hamiller process, a radiopaque structure which is tapered, which is found posterior to tuberosity, right? So that represents Hamiller process, and it's an extension of medial pterygoid plate of spinoid bone. Just 1 second. Yeah. Right. So we have this second image where you can see a nasopalatine duct. I mean, the lining of nasopalatine duct. And then you have 3, which is nothing but nasopalatine fossa. 2 represents the border. So 2 and 7 represent the border of maxillary sinus. And 4 represents the floor of nasal fossa. And 6, it's lamina dura. 8 represents the pedial space. 5 represents the soft tissue reflection of your nose, right? And then we have this IOPA of mandibular posterior teeth third quadrant. So where you can see nutrient canals, 1 represents nutrient canals, 2 represents a trabecular bone pattern, 3 represents the border of inferior alar canal, and 4 is submandibular fossa, and 5 represents the inferior border of mandible. And then coming to the IOPA of maxillary posterior region, second quadrant, as you can see, this is all the maxillary sinus lining, right? So one represents the anterior border of maxillary sinus, two represents the inferior nasal concha, three represents the floor of nasal cavity, four represents the anterior border of maxillary process of, zygomatic process of maxilla. So we have this entire part, the zygomatic process of maxilla, where this is the inferior border and this is the posterior wall. And then we have this zygomatic arch, which is represented by 6, and 7 represents the tuberosity, and 8 represents the mucosa over the alveolar bone, right? And then we have again IOPA of mandibular posterior teeth, third quadrant. So one represents the CEJ, two represents the mental foramen, and three represents submandibular gland fossa. So mandibular anterior IOPA. So one represents, I think it's not clear, right? So again, I need to modify the contrast and sharpness. So one represents the torii, mandibular torii. We have a lingual foramen surrounded by genial tubercles, right? I hope you have seen that previously where I have modified the sharpness. And then we have this one section of the OPG. So as you can see, 14 represents the inferior border of mandibles, 12 inferior alveolar nerve canal border, 11 the reflection of pinna, and then we have these structures, right? Air filled space, nasal fossa, and then we have this nasal septum, anterior nasal spine, and we have lateral wall of nasal cavity, inferior infraorbital margin, and then infraorbital canal lining, and pterygomaxillary fissure. 7 representing the pterygoid process, pterygoid play. 8 represents the zygomatic arch. 9 the posterior border of maxillary sinus. 10 it's the zygomatic process of maxilla, the posterior border. And 11, 12 as we have discussed previously. So finally we have the components of the X-ray tube, which I just wanted to project to you for sake of completion of topic, right? So we have these anode cathodes, all the structures I think you're all quite familiar with. So we have this tungsten film, the filament, the cathode as well as anode made up of same material, tungsten, tungsten filament, and then tungsten target, copper stem, vacuum. So we have this leaded glass case, electrons, X-rays, that's it, right? So molybdenum focusing cup. And you can see the tungsten target, which is inclined with a specific angulation, right? So all that we have discussed extensively in one of the previous lectures, right? So I hope it's clear. If you have any doubts or any queries or any suggestions, they're always welcome, right? Yes, sir, George. Right. So we'll try to have more such sessions, right? Using our screen, we'll try to have as many sessions as possible so that it will be of use. Especially these image-based questions, we always have this apprehension, right? So we'll try to minimize or remove that apprehension through process of discussing as many image-based questions as possible, right? So based on the feedback I got, I've incorporated one live session for image-based discussion. So we'll try to increase the frequency as well as duration, right? Okay, so we'll conclude then. Yeah, so this session we focused only on the normal anatomic landmarks, right? In the coming sessions pertaining to radiology, we'll try to focus on various anomalies or pathologies, or even we have these artifacts, right? So we'll try to cover different categories of these image-based questions in each subject as we move on, right? So if you have any questions, you can drop them. I'll stay online for another few minutes. It's already 10 to 9. Yeah, general surgery also will try to have image-based questions. Definitely. We'll try covering all the subjects, right? So far, I think we have covered maybe 4 or 5 subjects. We'll do every week. Yeah, sure. Yes, Priya, we'll definitely consider that, right? We'll show the aerial pictures, also anatomic pictures. They'll be much more helpful. Kavya, say periodontics and oral maxillofacial surgery. Yes, Kavya, definitely we'll have them in the coming weeks, right? Yes, DADH. As I said, we'll cover all the subjects. I just go through the schedule of our comprehensive batch. We're just following this the schedule given to them. So this week, since we have this pharmacology and general medicine, as I thought it's not relevant, like we'll try to focus on other subjects also. So I have put up this radiology. But if at all we have pedo, surgery, DADH, anatomy, we'll try to cover image based, or we'll try to have image based questions pertaining to those subjects only, right? I haven't yet decided to be, definitely I'll decide and I'll let you know, right? I'll always let you know on Sunday. Every Sunday I'll leave the schedule out. I'll also share that in our WhatsApp update group. Okay. Okay, if you have this facility of using WhatsApp, you can join our update group, or you can just drop a mail to us. If you want, we can send you the updates along with our registered students. Yeah, dental histology also we need to cover a lot. Lashwari, you're glad to hear that. You say this is amazing. Image-based radiology is really helpful. Yeah. So every week we'll try to cover at least 1 or 2 subjects, right? So one subject I feel that's more appropriate, rather than trying to have a lot many types of different area of questions in a single session. So each session we'll try to focus on one subject. Okay. Yes. Next we have anatomy. Yes, Prithvi. Glad to hear that. Right, so tomorrow we have a general session, so I'll be out of station, but still I will try to be live by 7:30. As I said, we'll have Saturday's live session, general session at 7:30 p.m. So we're going to have something interesting tomorrow. So we'll try to understand each personality every week, and we'll see what lessons we can learn from their achievements or from their life experiences, right? So that's the focus of our Saturday session, right? So trying to imbibe qualities from various great personalities who have sacrificed so much, not only for themselves but for the sake of society and for the sake of people around them, right? So we'll try have a general session tomorrow at 7:30 p.m. Okay, so see you tomorrow again. I hope this session was useful for you, and if you have anything, any queries or any feedback, you can drop us at proudtobedentist@gmail.com, right? Yeah, we'll conclude that, okay? Yes, Priya, definitely. Priya, why don't you mail me proudtobedentist@gmail.com, right? So we can discuss over there, right? Thank you. Kavya, I was in college. Yes, I have seen your mail, but I thought like replying you after I complete my session, because I had other works also, right? I've seen your mail and thank you so much, and I'll definitely reply you. So typically I take not more than 24 hours to reply an email. So that's my personal deadline, which I have set. It's like a standard, right? So any mail I'll be answering within 24 hours, as soon as possible, but not exceeding 24 hours, right? Alvin, you also sent, okay, yeah, I'll definitely answer, right? I think you sent me today itself, right? Today afternoon or morning session, I think. Ben is thank you. Because most often people see online, it's all about trust, right? So how can you just believe or trust whatever I say? So online, it's all about trust. So it really takes a lot of time, energy and patience to build up the trust. And I don't know how far I have succeeded in building up the trust between us, right? So it's really complex process, right? So definitely I will try answering as soon as possible, okay? So the first thing I'm going to do after completing this session is I will answer your mails, okay? Hi Purvil, just about to conclude our session. Yeah, anyways, you can just watch our recorded video, okay? Rohit, you got to play 1.5 hours, okay? Please don't calculate that way because I feel the pressure. If you say 1.5 hours, next time the others might also expect me to answer within 1 hour or 2 hours, which is sometimes not possible for me. Yeah, sometimes I reply in 20 minutes, sometimes I reply in 1 or 2 minutes also. If I'm online, if I am checking my mails, I'll definitely reply within 1 or 2 minutes, right? But typically, I mean, it's our personal deadline. Like from our academy, we have put this deadline of replying or clearing all mails within 24 hours. It can be a general mail, it can be a subject mail, no matter what category it belongs to, right? So that's the plan which we have been implementing for the past 9 months, and hopefully we haven't broken that deadline so far. No, please don't give the time frame, because again Kavya might feel bad because since I haven't answered her mails yet. Okay, right, so we'll just conclude. We'll see you again tomorrow. Right, bye, take care, all the best, prepare well, give your best, and the best comes to you always, right? Bye, good night. Spokoj noc noci. And we're missing Regina today. Yeah, yes Priya, yeah, bye. Bye Sairaj, good night. Hi Ravindra, just concluding our session. Glad you joined us live. Take it. Bye.